My name is Jinchuan Xing, and I'm an assistant professor at the Genetics Department. My lab working on human genomes. More specifically, we are interested in genomic variations, that is, how different our genomes are across individuals. So if you think about our genomes, we are about 99.9% identical, any given a pair of individuals. And we are interested in that 0.1% of the genome that's different between us, because that's what makes everybody unique. The human genome is very big, it's about 3 billion base pair long. So there are, you can think it of a book with 3 billion letters in it. It records everything about how you're going to shape up being a human, essentially. In my lab, we roughly have 3 general directions of things we work on. So the first one is we want to understand the impact of genomic variation. And one particular type of variation we are interested in is called transportable elements. So these are very interesting fragment of DNA sequences. So the sequences, for example, what we call allele elements is a sequence that's about 300 base pair in length. It's a small DNA fragment, but it has a remarkable ability to jump around in our genome and make copy of itself during the process. So if you look at any of one of our genomes, there is about 1 million copy of this small DNA fragments that's been replicated since the appearance of primates. So if you do the math, there are about 10% of our genomes are these all 1 million copy of these 300 base pair small pieces. And when they jump around, sometimes they will land in a gene by accident. And if the gene is important, you get a disease. The second direction we've worked on is try to use genomic sequence to figure out the evolutionary history of human. Most of the questions you want to answer is written in the genome already. You just have to figure out where to look, and you know what happens in the past. Because during our evolution, the mutations are accumulated over time, right? You don't get 3 million positions that's different across individual at once. You get them, you know, from your ancestor and the ancestor of your ancestors and so forth. So if you can model a process, you can compare that to the data to infer what happens in the past. So in that way, we can get the idea, for example, when people populated European and when people populated East Asian and how the population size have changed over time. And that gave us a baseline on how variable our genome is, which have important implication in the risk to disease. And the third component of my research is identifying mutations that cause or underlying human diseases. And now, because the revolution in sequencing technology, now we have the ability to sequence many, many genomes of the individual have a certain disease. And then you can compare that to the genome of normal individual and say which gene was broken or affected by mutations in this individual have disease compared to normal people. In the last 5 years also, there is a very dramatic change in technology. What we have now is generally called the next generation sequencing technology. It literally revolutionized the field. For example, when you think about the Human Genome Project, we spent about 10 years and $3 billion to sequence one genome. But now with this next generation sequencing technology, we can do the same thing in about 2 weeks, and it only costs about $5,000. So this is a million times reduction in cost and really opens up the opportunity of many, many research projects that weren't possible even 5 years ago. For students who are interested in genetics or genomics, now is a great time to get into the genomic field, especially human genomics, because I can see in the next decades, it's going to be very exciting A lot of theories and questions we developed during the last many years, now we actually have the data to look at it, to address these questions. So I would really encourage students to get into the human genomics field right now.